Hey, I know you. You're that jaywalking punk anarchist.
Hello, this is the Radical Reviewer, taking a look at Mistakes Were Made, But Not By Me. Why We Justify Foolish Beliefs, Bad Decisions, and Hurtful Acts. By Carol Tavris and Elliot Aronson. Harcourt Publishing, 2007. The key idea of this text is dissonance theory, a theory designed to explain how self-justification works, or rather, doesn't work, regarding our ability to confess, take responsibility for, and potentially learn from our mistakes. Basically, this book is about why we often refuse to learn from our mistakes or admit that we were wrong. I decided to look at this book, you know, apropos of nothing. You know, like, for whatever reason, I wanted to discuss how and why people avoid taking responsibility for their mistakes. How they try to cover up or downplay or make excuses for mistakes or refuse to admit that they were wrong. You know, like, I just kind of decided, like, for no particular reason to, you know, just, like, whatever.
Q is not one person, okay? Q is a bunch of people. They're on the inside. They're the good guys.
I refuse to put a mask on. I'm in a free country. They're taking away our amendment rights. They're taking away our freedoms.
So I present to you the top five global warming, I mean climate change myths.
I am 100% behind Q. He's working for the president. He's working for our country.
Well, there's obviously voter fraud. I mean, there's evidence of voter fraud all over the country.
Yep, no reason. No reason at all. Anyway, all that said, let's take a look at the text in depth. Introduction: Knaves, Fools, Villains, and Hypocrites. How do they live with themselves? Now, you've probably seen a politician get confronted by a journalist, or you've seen any online debate, or maybe you've had a heated exchange in the marketplace of ideas yourself. And if you have, you've seen that most people, when directly confronted with proof that they are wrong, did not change their point of view or course of action, but justify it even more tenaciously. Which is like, you can say that's obvious, but it's kind of weird, right? Like, why don't we change our minds when confronted with proof that we are wrong? Well, this is done through self-justification. We feel discomfort from being challenged, and we solve this discomfort with self-justification. As Tavris and Aronson explain it, self-justification not only minimizes our mistakes and bad decisions, it is also the reason that everyone can see a hypocrite in action except the hypocrite. It allows us to create a distinction between our moral lapses and someone else's, and to blur the discrepancy between our actions and our moral convictions. Basically, self-justification is more than just lying or making excuses. It's about lying to ourselves. Chapter 1: Cognitive Dissonance, The Engine of Self-Justification. To start, Tavris and Aronson define cognitive dissonance as a state of tension that occurs whenever a person holds two cognitions, ideas, attitudes, beliefs, opinions, that are psychologically inconsistent. Let's run through one of my favorite examples. Let's say, hypothetically, for the sake of argument, that I am a small government Republican. I think the government needs to get off my back and out of my business. Let's say, hypothetically, I also want armed guards in front of every bathroom to make sure you got the proper genitalia before going in. Well, these are two totally inconsistent, cognitively dissonant opinions that are held by many people. Tavris and Aronson explain that when we experience cognitive dissonance, when we are confronted with evidence that we're wrong, we tend to criticize, distort, or dismiss the evidence in order to maintain or even strengthen our beliefs. They explain that this has even been demonstrated with MRI studies, where it was shown that the reasoning centers of the brain literally shut down when people are shown information they disagree with, and that the emotional centers of the brain light up when shown information that they agree with. This is probably why some folks would swear up and down that Bernie Sanders was going to win the Democratic primary, or that Trump was going to win re-election, or whatever happens to be the relevant equivalent at the time that you're watching this video. People's brains literally turn off to information that challenges their beliefs. Tavris and Aronson state, The more costly a decision in terms of time, money, effort, or inconvenience, and the more irrevocable its consequences, the greater the dissonance and the greater the need to reduce it by overemphasizing the good things about the choice made. So, going back to the Bernie and Trump examples, someone who vaguely favored one or the other might not have that much self-justification to do about their decision, but perhaps they had a few Bernie bumper stickers or a giant Trump flag on their vehicle. Maybe they did canvassing for their preferred candidate. Maybe they stormed the Capitol. Now, time and money and effort and inconvenience have been put in, and they will likely feel much more dissonance and will want to engage in self-justification to justify all that exerted time and energy. And this, of course, works for any deeply held beliefs. Anti or pro-gun regulation, evolution versus intelligent design, various religious beliefs or lack thereof, climate change, taste in music, you name it. Tavris and Aronson call the understanding of our use of self-justification to solve dissonance, dissonance theory. And this self-justification can work in both positive and negative directions. For example, let's say that you did something nice or mean to someone, gave them a cupcake, or maybe stole a cupcake from them. Dissonance theory suggests that you will justify that action. I did that to them, and I am a reasonable person, so they must have deserved what I did. Justifying your actions and opinions and impacting your future behavior. This leads to what Tavris and Aronson call the pyramid of choice. One chooses A or B, and self-justification reinforces that choice, and down the pyramid we go, further justifying the choice we made. Let's go back to the cupcake example. Let's say that A is to give the person a cupcake and B is to keep it for yourself. This puts you on the path down the pyramid of self-justification. A few weeks later, you'll feel more strongly, more justified in your choice than you initially felt. You'll be more likely to do the same act or even a more severe version of it in the future, because to do otherwise would be to admit that you were wrong. And Tavris and Aronson conclude, how do you get an honest man to lose his ethical compass? You get him to take one step at a time, and self-justification will do the rest. Chapter 2, Pride, Prejudice, and Other Blind Spots. This chapter argues that our brain has blind spots, but not only this, our brain actively hides these blind spots from us. Tavris and Aronson discuss a term called naive realism, which is essentially the idea that we believe we perceive things as they really are, because we are rational, and if people disagree with us, they are being irrational. Tavris and Aronson state, naive realism creates a logical labyrinth because it presupposes two things. One, people who are open-minded and fair ought to agree with a reasonable opinion. And two, any opinion I hold must be reasonable. If it weren't, I wouldn't hold it. Tavris and Aronson go on to discuss medical scientists and doctors corrupted by money and small gifts, chasing the money on patents for new medications, or being motivated to recommend one drug over another to their patients. Perhaps you've heard the story of the door-to-door salesman who couldn't get customers to buy his combs, so then he started giving away one free comb, and then the customers felt like they owed him one, and so they were more likely to buy his combs in the future when they did need one? Similarly, medical scientists and doctors feel this motivation when receiving money for new patents or small gifts from drug companies. Are they corrupt? Are they accepting bribes? Well, of course not. It's just the cost of doing business. It's the way things are. These small gifts aren't enough to impact my professional judgment. This corrupt money helps me to fund my more altruistic actions, or whatever it is they tell themselves. It's self-justification to the rescue.
If you hold a patent for a particular drug, no one else can produce that drug for a certain period of time. When that time is nearly up, you can simply make a small change to the formula, refile the patent, and boom, you've just secured your monopoly for another 20 years. That's exactly what the big insulin producers have been doing. And here's the absurd part. You don't even need to improve the product. You just need to change it, and you need to be able to prove that it's not objectively worse.
Tavris and Aronson explain that dissonance and prejudice work in both directions. A stereotype might evoke discrimination, or maybe discrimination evokes a self-justifying stereotype. Let's say a manager doesn't hire a black applicant. Is this because they were thinking of the stereotypes of the lazy criminal thug black person popularized in media, Or did they refuse to hire the black applicant and then justified that decision after the fact by considering them lazy criminal thugs? Either way, the prejudice is self-justifying. And Tavris and Aronson conclude the chapter explaining how prejudice is affected by our cognitive dissonance. Our prejudice justifies the ill treatment we want to inflict on others, and we want to inflict ill treatment on others because we don't like them. And why don't we like them? Because they are competing with us for jobs in a scarce market. Because their presence makes us doubt that we have the one true religion. Because we want to preserve our positions of status, power, and privilege. Because we need to feel we are better than somebody. Because our country is waging war against them. Because we are uncomfortable with their customs. Especially their sexual customs, those promiscuous perverts. Because they refuse to assimilate into our culture. Because they're trying too hard to assimilate into our culture. Chapter 3, Memory, the Self-Justifying Historian. Tavris and Aronson start the chapter by explaining that we never tell the truth. Not the whole truth, anyway. And not because we are lying, but because, with self-justification, we unintentionally add and omit details. They state, memory smooths out the wrinkles of dissonance by enabling the confirmation bias to hum along, selectively causing us to forget discrepant, discomforting information about beliefs we hold dear. This is in part done through a concept called source confusion, that memories, even memories we think that we remember very clearly, are actually all mixed up with family stories and photographs and videos and things we've seen on TV and stuff like that. An example from the text was an experiment in which 14-year-old boys were interviewed about their lives, and then interviewed again 34 years later. And the study found that their ability to remember their own childhoods was no better than chance. Tavris and Aronson then discuss a concept called imagination inflation. They state, the more you imagine something, the more likely you are to inflate it into an actual memory, adding details as you go. And I'm sure you've heard of things like, if you start thinking that you've been exercising more than usual, this will cause you to feel like you have been, even if it isn't true. Or maybe, when you reward yourself for eating healthy by eating junk food, this will cause you to think that you've actually been eating more healthy than you really were. Self-justification through imagining things into reality. Tavris and Aronson then discuss false memories about alien abductions, and they conclude, fake memories allow us to forgive ourselves and justify our mistakes, but sometimes at a high price, an inability to take responsibility for our lives. Chapter 4, Good Intentions, Bad Science, The Closed Loop of Clinical Judgment. Tavris and Aronson start the chapter by discussing the craze about recovering repressed memories of child abuse. Now, I don't know if you're an old pup like me, but back in the 90s, there was this craze about recovering repressed memories of child abuse. Now, repressed memories can happen, but if you're like me, perhaps you have several friends and family members who were abused, and it turns out, you tend to forget the things that you want to remember, and you can't forget the things that you wish you could. But how does something like a repressed memory craze happen? Well, Tavris and Aronson compare various mental health professionals and find that clinical psychologists typically have PhDs and understand psychological research, where psychiatrists understand medicine but typically not the psychological research aspect of things. And psychotherapists, well, apparently psychotherapist is basically this widely unregulated term which a person can claim without much training. Essentially, when things like a craze around repressed memories of child abuse sweep the nation, it's helped by the fact that psychotherapists are often not well versed in psychological research, and so they're more likely to make mistakes and then reinforce those mistakes through self-justification. Tavris and Aronson explain that their argument isn't to throw therapy under the bus or anything like that, but rather to examine the kinds of mistakes that can result from the closed loop of clinical practice, and show how self-justification perpetuates them. One of the mistakes often made is that therapy often involves looking for confirming evidence of a belief, but not disconfirming evidence. Like, what would be disconfirming evidence regarding repressed memories? Without a control group, without research and experimentation, confirming evidence creates false positives. Thankfully, the repressed memories of sexual abuse craze was eventually debunked through studies looking for disconfirming evidence. For example, Tavris and Aronson describe a study that found that children are actually much more susceptible to suggestion than originally thought. In the study, 80% of child participants confessed to false allegations of child abuse when they were suggested to them. Okay, so the craze was debunked. How did those who were caught up in the craze respond? Tavris and Aronson describe different ways dissonance was reduced. They state, "One popular method is by minimizing the extent of the problem and the damage it caused. Others reduce dissonance by blaming the victims. The most ideologically committed clinicians reduce dissonance by killing the messenger. There is one final way of reducing dissonance: dismiss all the scientific research as being part of a backlash." Basically, like many who are confronted with evidence that proves them wrong, rather than changing their opinions, most people, even people claiming to be experts in the field, made excuses, blamed others, and denied the evidence. Self-justification to the rescue, yet again. Chapter 5, Law and Disorder. This chapter looks into self-justification at work at every step of the criminal justice system. Investigators. Tavris and Aronson explain that studies show investigators can be impacted by confirmation bias. They state, "Once a detective decides that he or she has found the killer, the confirmation bias sees to it that the prime suspect becomes the only suspect." Tavris and Aronson go on to explain why cops would fake or plant evidence. They discuss various police departments that were charged with making false arrests, officers indicted for framing innocent people, brutalizing suspects, illegally tapping phones, losing or faking evidence, and things like that. And Tavris and Aronson conclude, "The first time you do it, you tell yourself, the guy is guilty. This experience will make it easier for you to do the same thing again. In fact, you will be strongly motivated to repeat the behavior, because to do otherwise is to admit, if only to yourself, that it was wrong the first time you did it. Eventually, many cops will take the next steps, proselytizing other officers, persuading them to behave as they have, and shunning or sabotaging officers who do not go along. They are a reminder of the moral road not taken." Interrogators. Tavris and Aronson discuss the false confessions coerced by what is called the Reed technique. They explain that, despite up to a quarter of confessions being confessions to crimes the person did not commit, the Reed technique insists that it is absurd to believe that a suspect who knows he did not commit a crime would place greater weight and credibility on alleged evidence than his own knowledge of his innocence. Tavris and Aronson argue that this creates a self-fulfilling prophecy. The interrogator's confidence of guilt causes them to see the suspect's behavior as suspicious, and then there is no such thing as disconfirming evidence. They state, "The Reed technique is thus a closed loop. My partners and I interrogated him for 12 hours using the Reed technique, and he confesses. Therefore, because innocent people never confess, his confession confirms my belief that his being nervous and sweaty, or too controlled, or looking me in the eye, or not, is a sign of guilt." In a way, self-justification here functions like it did for the false positives creating the repressed memories of child abuse craze from the previous chapter. Prosecutors. Here, Tavris and Aronson argue that although prosecutors are supposed to get to the truth regardless of guilt or innocence, it is often the effort that they put in to determining guilt that they fall into a self-justification cycle. Nothing proves this better than DNA evidence. Cases get overturned with DNA evidence, and yet prosecutors maintain that they caught the right person. One even going so far as to claim that an unintended co-ejaculator was involved in their rape case. So, despite DNA evidence showing otherwise, they swore that they convicted the real rapist. Okay, so every step of the criminal justice system is full of self-justification, which makes mistakes go uncorrected. How do we solve this? Tavris and Aronson argue that the antidote to these all-too-human mistakes is to ensure that in police academies and law schools, students learn about their own vulnerability to self-justification. And this means keeping an open mind when looking at suspects, understanding that intuition can be flawed, recognizing that confessions can be coerced, the dangers of confirmation bias, and that we might subconsciously overlook evidence that doesn't match what we think happened, and also that we probably should just abolish the police in general. Oh wait, no, they didn't say that. But you can look at my reviews of The New Jim Crow, or Our Prison's Obsolete, or my upcoming review of The End of Policing if you'd like to know more about criminal justice reform. Chapter 6. Love's Assassin. Self-Justification in Marriage. Tavris and Aronson explain that self-justification pops up in new and long-term relationships alike. Whether it's newlyweds overlooking any warning signs of trouble ahead, or unhappy couples tolerating their partner's cruelty to avoid facing the possibility that they've invested so much time and energy into a failed relationship. Next, Tavris and Aronson explain that we come up with environmental or implicit reasons for why people around us, or even ourselves, behave as we do. Our bad behavior was caused by our environment, but our good deeds are implicit to ourselves. And unhappy and happy couples do the same as well. Maybe we blame the other's unwillingness to change on personality flaws, but excuse our own unwillingness to change on personal virtue. You don't care enough about my interests, we always do what you want to do, and things like that. Or, I pick the music when I drive, that's just how I operate. I'm the type of person who needs a few beers after work, that's just who I am, and things like that. Tavris and Aronson argue that if you decide to stay in a bad relationship, you will justify the dissonance by downplaying it. It's not that bad, they have good qualities too, our fights aren't even that bad or that often. And if the relationship does end, and you're the one who is broken up with, you will reduce dissonance by talking yourself up to prove them wrong, or talking yourself down, dissing yourself to prove them right. And if you are the one that is doing the breaking up, you will reduce dissonance by justifying the pain that you've caused the other person. You will think, I'm a good person, I wouldn't hurt someone who didn't deserve it, so they must have deserved it. In fact, maybe they were even worse than I thought. And Tavris and Aronson conclude, successful, stable couples are able to listen to the partner's criticisms, concerns, and suggestions indefensively. They reduce the dissonance caused by small irritations by overlooking them, and they reduce the dissonance caused by their mistakes and major problems by solving them. Chapter 7, Wounds, Rifts, and Wars. The chapter starts with stories of self-justification from small stuff like couples having an affair to larger global events such as the Iran hostage crisis. And Tavris and Aronson explain that perpetrators are motivated to reduce their moral culpability. Victims are motivated to maximize their moral blamelessness. Depending on which side of the wall we are on, we systematically distort our memories and account of the event to produce the maximum consonance between what happened and how we see ourselves. Let's start from the perspective of the perpetrator. First, we deny wrongdoing. Then, downplay the wrongdoing. And lastly, when wrongplaying can't be downplayed, we push to get over it, to get past the wrongdoing, and move on.
We had to invade Iraq. They supported the terrorism that led to 9/11.
Well, maybe they didn't have anything to do with 9/11, but Saddam was a tyrant. We had to do something.
Okay. Maybe the Iraq invasion was a mistake, but like, there was a lot of confusion during that time, and like, that was over a decade ago. I think it's time to move on, don't you?
Next, Tavris and Aronson discuss the famous Milgram experiment, where participants gave increasing intensities of electric shocks to participants for giving wrong answers to a test, eventually giving what they believed to be deadly levels of electric shock. Now, the Milgram experiment is typically framed as being about obedience to authority, but Tavris and Aronson see this experiment as being about dissonance theory, about moving down the pyramid of self-justification. I would not harm a person who didn't deserve it, so this person must deserve what I'm doing. And it's only a small shock, so it's no big deal. This person is messing up more and more. They must be a real idiot, less than a person, less deserving of humane treatment. And with every increase in severity of shock, the participant justifies what they were doing. From here, Tavris and Aronson go on to discuss the use of torture by British and South African and Israeli and American torturers, who all justified their torture as, what I'm doing is to stop the bad guy, and these bad people are doing things worse than what I'm doing, so what I'm doing is justified. An example from the text is Republican Senator James Inhofe, who justified the torture of prisoners at Abu Ghraib because they were murderers and terrorists who probably had American blood on their hands, despite the fact that several military intelligence officers told the International Committee of the Red Cross that between 70 and 90% of the Iraqi detainees had been arrested by mistake. Tavris and Aronson explain that once torture is justified in rare cases, down the pyramid of self-justification we go. It's okay to torture some of those that we know were involved. Let's torture anyone we know is involved. Let's torture those that we suspect are involved. Let's torture those that we suspect know people that we suspect are involved. Let's torture this guy who might know a guy who might know another guy who might have some info, and so on. But this is about perpetrators. What about victims? Tavris and Aronson explain that victims can have long memories, and often victimhood is a matter of perspective. Look at the Middle East. What we're doing there is revenge for 9/11. But 9/11 was revenge for US activity in the Middle East in the 80s and 90s. And US activity in the 80s and 90s was revenge for the Iranian Revolution and Iraq invading Kuwait. And the Iranian Revolution and Iraq were responses to US action in the Middle East in the 50s and 70s. And on it goes. Eventually, we start talking about the Crusades. Tavris and Aronson explain that there are three ways out of the cycle of revenge between perpetrator and victim. One is for the perpetrator to put aside their feelings and acknowledge the victim's anger. The second is for the victim to unilaterally let go, expressing pain rather than anger. And the third way, which is most difficult but also most successful, is for both sides to drop their self-justification. And Tavris and Aronson conclude, understanding without vengeance, reparation without retaliation, are possible only if we are willing to stop justifying our own position. Chapter 8, Letting Go and Owning Up. Tavris and Aronson start by explaining that even though self-justification reduces dissonance and protects our self-esteem when we make mistakes, the energy extended is largely unnecessary and even harms us. In fact, admitting our mistakes doesn't only help those harmed, but it can also be liberating for ourselves. Tavris and Aronson add that, perhaps the greatest lesson of dissonance theory is that we can't wait around for people to have moral conversions, personality transplants, sudden changes of heart, or new insights that will cause them to sit up straight, admit error, and do the right thing. Most human beings and institutions are going to do everything in their power to reduce dissonance in ways that are favorable to them, that allow them to justify their mistakes and maintain business as usual. Tavris and Aronson argue that we need to be aware of dissonance, be more conscious of our choices, rather than letting automatic self-justification resolve our dissonance for us. We need to learn to fail and to not fear risks. This is part of experimentation and the creative process. If we can't afford to fail or be wrong, we won't learn from our mistakes. And Tavris and Aronson conclude, the test of a nation's character and of an individual's integrity does not depend on being error-free. It depends on what we do after making the error. And they close with a quote from a Chinese philosopher who wrote, a great nation is like a great man. When he makes a mistake, he realizes it. Having realized it, he admits it. Having admitted it, he corrects it. He considers those who point out his faults as his most benevolent teachers. Conclusion. I had thought that it was this book, but it might have been the book The Art of Changing the Brain, which explained an experiment in which people who had strong views on a subject were put in a room with people who had the opposite view, so that each side could challenge the other. And then another group was put in a room of people who shared the same view as themselves, and had their views reinforced. And it turns out, neither environment led to people changing their mind. Everyone left the experiment feeling more strongly about their original position. Dissonance theory tells us that they all engaged in self-justification. It almost seems impossible to change people's minds about things, to admit when we're wrong. The science, the various experiments have proven this. So I guess we're doomed. We're stuck and incapable of changing anyone's minds or even of having our own mind changed, right? But wait, that's not always totally true, is it? I mean, I used to think that anti-civ primitivism was the only way to truly address climate change. I used to think that economic protectionism was the best way to support workers' rights. Hell, I used to be religious. Now, none of these changes in opinion happened because of one interaction with contrary evidence. In fact, the science is probably right on this one. I was probably quick to ignore and downplay evidence that was inconvenient for my beliefs. But over time, as I reflected on my beliefs and regarded counter-arguments and counter-evidence, I did realize I was wrong and changed my ways. If we reflect on our beliefs and the various sorts of information that we've seen, we can come away with a fresh perspective. We can change our brains. We can even put self-justification in check and admit that mistakes were made and it was our fault. Now, when it comes to admitting we're wrong, when it comes to understanding self-justification, why we and others are so quick to downplay or ignore when we make mistakes, the terms and studies and explanations found in this text, dissonance theory and all that, mistakes were made but not by me, is incredibly helpful in conversations with ourselves and others regarding understanding and admitting and learning from our mistakes, when it comes to admitting that we were wrong. And as always, I'd like to thank my wonderful patrons. Your tremendous support has allowed me to get dog insurance, which is wonderful. You've allowed me to support other creators I couldn't otherwise support. Gotta love that. You've helped me demonstrate that making this YouTube channel, it wasn't a mistake. It wasn't a mistake, Mom! And you provide me with funds for books and dog toys and stuff like that, which is really awesome. I appreciate you folks a lot. And if you like what I do here and you want to support the show, you can go to patreon.com/radicalreviewer. And if you're interested in radical theory, looking for a book recommendation or whatever, you can get your radical reviews here with the Radical Reviewer. Thanks for watching.
Maybe rivalries are dumb. Maybe you don't settle them with petty competitions. Maybe the only way to be the best is by ending the fighting and working together.